Hachette Audio presents The Animals Among Us, How Pets Make Us More Human, written by John Bradshaw, read by Graeme Malcolm. To my lovely wife, Nikki, who introduced me to the joys of keeping pets. Preface. Why keep pets? Such a question will never have occurred to some people. There has always been a dog at home, or a cat, or maybe rabbits or guinea pigs. So many households in the West include pets nowadays that it's salutary to note that a mere 2 centuries ago, when domestic animals were everywhere, pet keeping was almost exclusively the prerogative of the rich. Of course, increasing affluence has allowed many more people to keep animals as companions, but that alone cannot explain the massive surge in pet ownership in the last century. Survey after survey shows that people feel deep emotional attachment to their pets and think of them as one of the family. Where does this passion come from? I believe that it stems from deep within our nature and provides insight into what makes us human. Many of the Stone Age tribes whose way of life survived into the 20th century kept animals as companions. A capacity to regard animals as friends and not merely as food may therefore be as ancient as our species. It has never become universal, however. Lots of people feel no attachment to animals or inclination to keep them as pets. Any theory as to why pets are such an important part of many people's lives must take account of that fact. I came to write this book as a scientist as much as an animal enthusiast. Indeed, I started life as something of a pet agnostic. My father didn't like cats or dogs, so there were no pets in my childhood, apart from those I encountered when visiting relatives and neighbors. As a biologist in the making, I saw pets mainly as interesting and accessible animals, not all that different from the birds that visited the feeders in our garden, or the deer that we'd sometimes disturb on family walks in the countryside where we lived. We'd inherited the tradition of walking, with or without a dog, from my mother's family. My wife, who had grown up with dogs, cats, and at one point an unintended greenhouse full of rabbits, introduced me to the joys of greetings from a wet nose and wagging tail, not to mention what still feels like the privilege of sharing a home with a purring but undoubtedly independent felid. As I became a professional biologist, I initially studied animals, not people, and certainly not the relationship between the two. Even when studying dog and cat behavior, I found myself somewhat professionally isolated. Back in the 1980s, the study of any kind of domestic animal, let alone the ultimate artificialities that are pet dogs and cats, was deeply unfashionable. A brief flurry of interest in their biology in the 1960s, when veterinarians like Dr. Michael Fox established some of the basics, such as the need to expose domestic dogs to the right kind of contact with people during their socialization period, had quickly died away. The current surge of interest in dog behavior would have been unimaginable in the early stages of my career. I was initially drawn into studying dogs and then cats because I was researching the ways that animals of all kinds use scent to communicate. Theirs is a world of smelly information to which we humans, with perhaps the least sensitive noses of any mammal, are oblivious. I soon became fascinated by the behavior of both cat and dog, and not just the part governed by scent. I came to recognize in it an enthralling compromise between their wild origins as canid and felid and the requirements of their modern domestic lifestyles. And I became increasingly aware that their behavior could not be divorced from how their owners behaved and thought about them. It soon dawned on me that although I might think about cats and dogs as mammals while at work, at home, neither I nor anyone else viewed our pets in this way. Most owners treat these animals as little people, talking to them as if they understand what is being said. I seemed to do this as much as anyone else, despite being well aware that such comprehension was almost certainly impossible. Once I began to think about pets in their domestic context, it followed that more than just their physical surroundings and the various purposes we have put them to down the ages have shaped the dogs and cats of today. The workings of our own brains have indirectly moulded them, and now that we have largely liberated them from their former utilitarian roles, these influences are becoming ever more paramount. Their cuteness attracts us, well, most of us, instinctively. The features that kittens and puppies, and to a lesser extent adult cats and some dogs, share with human babies seem to trigger our protective and caring side. Our brains also perceive intention in almost anything that moves, and thus without a moment's reflection, we automatically ascribe all kinds of human-like emotions and intentions to our animals. Some of these are probably reasonably accurate, others are wildly imaginative. Generally, the errors don't matter, but sometimes they do, as when our pets fall short of the often unrealistic expectations we have of them. I eventually concluded that we simply can never understand the behavior of pet animals without factoring in the workings of the human mind. This realization kindled my interest in what the few academics with any interest in the subject back in the 1980s referred to as the human-animal bond. I began to attend conferences that included the topic of pet ownership. At a workshop on the day after one such conference, as it happened also my 40th birthday, I and six other academics present coined the term anthrozoology to sum up what we all did and to give a distinctive title to the society we founded a year later, the International Society for Anthrozoology. Not that we could take credit for creating this word from scratch, we had adapted it from the title of an academic journal, Anthrozoos, which had published its first issue 3 years previously. The word stuck, and now, a quarter century on, students can earn a qualification in anthrozoology from universities all around the world. The field mainly brings together various types of scientists, biologists, veterinarians, medical researchers, psychologists, social scientists, and anthropologists to study the personal relationships that people have with animals, and to a lesser extent, that animals have with people. Thus, anthrozoology has focused most on those types of animals that serve widely as companions: dogs, cats, horses, aquarium fish, leisure horses, and so on. A parallel movement, sometimes referred to as human-animal studies, has grown up among those interested in more philosophical approaches, such as ethics, political science, history, geography, and literature. There is unfortunately not much dialogue between the two camps. In some senses, I've been writing this book for more than 20 years. The more I studied pets and their owners, the more intrigued I became. Despite sometimes suffering due to our misunderstanding of their requirements, cats and dogs were obviously benefiting from their relationships with people. There are far more of them in the world today than there are of the wild ancestors from which they emerged thousands of years ago. Yet, somewhat paradoxically, their numbers actually grew just as their usefulness to us disappeared. Only a few dogs still herd sheep or help with hunting. Most owners find their cats' once valued hunting prowess appalling. Pets' hold on their owners seems to run deeper than mere fashion. So, using as wide a range of sources as I could find, in addition to as much original research as I could fit in around my studies of cat and dog welfare, I set out to examine what science has to say about humans' fascination with animals and why we took them into our homes. This book is the result. Conventions. In this book, I have resisted following the growing practice in the United States of referring to pets as companions, and throughout I refer to owners rather than guardians or parents, labels preferred by some authorities. Perhaps I'm old-fashioned, but to me, pet ownership implies responsibility and certainly does not suggest a right to treat an animal like the inanimate sort of possession. I have a concern that the term guardian implies a legal status that arises from some mental deficiency in the animal, hardly an appropriate way to characterize the relationship between pet and owner. Caregiver, another suggestion I've seen, seems too impersonal and transient, more appropriate for those devoted souls who look after pets in rehoming facilities. Pet parent is simply too anthropomorphic for me to stomach. For a biologist like myself, the term parent indicates, though not exclusively, a genetic relationship between mother or father and offspring. In this book, I also occasionally...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.